Ready, we can start.
I'm ready.
First, let me introduce to those who are participants here that we are going to have the 23rd university lecture series today. And we are very fortunate that we have in our midst a renowned public intellectual, a renowned political scientist, a renowned thinker, Professor Viku Parekh. And I have got some claim over him, because I worked with him at Hull University some time ago. And I am quite happy to let you know that I learned a lot from Professor Parekh. And I remember the discussion which we had in the department, outside the department, and also at his home. And I must express my gratitude to Pramila ji. Pramila ji was very courteous and very hospitable whenever I visited Parekh's family. So here is Professor Parekh. And Professor Parekh, this is the lecture series which I started when I joined the Vishwabharati as his Vice Chancellor. And the first lecture was given by Professor Dilip Chakrabarty, the Cambridge Don, on archaeology of India. And then we had many intellectuals who visit Shantiniketan. And last, I think week before last, we had Professor Meghnad Desai. And then just before him, we had Professor Claiborne Carson from Stanford University. So we are really, really fortunate to have you in our midst. And let me tell you, friends, that Professor Parekh was quite keen to visit Vishwabharati sometime earlier this year, but because of some medical emergency, he couldn't do it. But as he said, he gave a commitment to come to Vishwabharati whenever he comes to India. So with this, in a few words, Professor Parekh, I welcome you to Vishwabharati, in virtual mode. And I'm looking forward to your visit in person in course of time. And today he will speak on a particular very interesting theme. Why is Mahatma Gandhi the father of nation? Now, Professor Parekh, the floor is yours, and please continue.
Well, thank you, Vidyu. Am I audible?
Yes, you are, perfectly.
So I begin by thanking the Vice Chancellor and my good friend, Professor Vidyu Chakrabarty, for inviting me to deliver a lecture on Gandhi during his 150th birth anniversary. Like many others in India, I had long taken for granted that it was right to call Mahatma Gandhi the father of the nation. I'd assumed that this was self-evident. That belief was shaken last year when a young historian asked me at a public meeting whether and why I held this view. I offered the usual reasons, but he was obviously not satisfied. And on reflection, nor was I. So the subject as to why Gandhi has been called the father of the nation has concerned me ever since. I haven't come up with a knockdown answer. When Professor Chakrabarty invited me, I thought I had a good opportunity to speak about the subject and pick your brain. And that's what I intend to do this morning. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, Professor Parekh. Carry on.
Can I? Because my screen has gone blank.
No. Can you see me now?
So you have disappeared from the screen.
No, I disappeared deliberately.
Okay. So I can continue.
Yes, please, please.
So I want to discuss the subject of my title. Before we do that, an important distinction has to be made between founding a nation and founding a state. A nation refers to a fairly cohesive body of people sharing common goals and interests and bound by a sense of mutual belonging. A state, by contrast, is an institutionalized system of power, specifying who wields what power to do what and how these various centers of power are related to each other. Founders of nation are not necessarily founders of state, and vice versa. Gandhi, for example, was founder of the Indian nation, the subject I intend to discuss, but had very little to do with the foundation of the Indian state, for which the credit must go to Pandit Nehru, Vallabhbhai Patel, and others. A similar sort of distinction has to be drawn at a slightly different level. Distinction between founding a state and running a state, or founding a nation and continuing it. Founding a nation is the most demanding job, or founding a state is the most demanding job, as laying the foundations of a building always is. It requires a supreme intelligence to see how future will shape, what institutions will survive, what institutions are needed to create what kinds of people, and in general, to shape the future of the country for the next few generations. Running is equally important, but doesn't require or call for the same degree of skills and ingenuity. Because founding a state or founding a nation is a demanding job, it requires spatial recognition, which is why first generation in any country generally gets credit for all sorts of things for which the subsequent generations do not. In Rome, for example, Peter Petria, father of the fatherland, was a title conferred by the syndicate, by the Senate. In Thailand today, for example, the monarch is given the title, and disloyalty to him is seen as a criminal offense, almost blasphemy. In other countries, the title used is not father of the nation, the title used is the elder brother, or leader, or founder. In some countries, the title is conferred formally by the constitution. In others, it acquires public credibility informally by frequent use. In some countries, it is given and withdrawn. In others, once given, it cannot be withdrawn. For example, in Bangladesh, Sheikh Mujibur Rahman was given the title by the Constitution of 1972, but the title was withdrawn in 2004. In some countries, it is against the law to give a title, but it is still widely used. For example, India. In India, Atal Datt Sharma moved the Supreme Court to confer the title Father of the Nation on Mahatma Gandhi, but the Supreme Court denied, declaring that the Indian Constitution only allows academic and military titles. That raises some important questions. What is a title? A doctorate is a title. If I'm a doctor of philosophy or science, is doctorate a title or is it not? And you say, well, I have worked for it, is it passing an exam? Well, what about an honorary doctorate? Is that a title? Likewise, Padma Awards, Padma Shri, Padma Bhushan, Padma Vibhushan, is it a title or is it not? And I have always been puzzled. I was told that because it's not a title, it can never be used as a prefix. You can't say Padma Bhushan Vidhu Chakravarti. You can only say Vidhu Chakravarti Padma Bhushan because it's not a title. In India, whenever I go to a meeting and there is a Padma Shri present, he's always referred to as Padma Shri so-and-so. And in my speech, I generally find myself correcting this speaker and saying, look, it should not be used as a prefix, it can only be used as a suffix. Likewise, His Royal Highness introducing a monarchy. Is that a title or is it not a title? During independence struggle, unofficial titles were freely given. And Gandhiji was good at it. Sardar Patel, now Sardar is a title. Lokmanya Tilak, Deen Bandhu. Are these not titles? And if they are not titles, if they are titles, why are they allowed? And it's just because they are informal. But then they can be expressed in public, introducing somebody in a public meeting we should be able to say, no, you can't call him Lokmanya or Sardar, because it's a title and we don't have a title in public. So I think there is this great deal of confusion in India about what constitutes a title and what cannot be given or expressed in public. The same situation applies with respect to Rashtrapita. Is the father of the nation a title? I don't think so, because you can't introduce him as father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi. You can only say Mahatma Gandhi, father of the nation. But what if you say Rashtrapati Mahatma Gandhi? It becomes a title. And if it becomes a title, is it consistent with the constitution? And if it is not, should you be using it? Well, anyway, there are enough difficulties about the title, but I want to turn on to what the title indicates, which is, when we refer to Mahatma Gandhi, it's important that here was a man who enjoyed three titles throughout his life. Not throughout his life, but more or less throughout his adult life. First was Mahatma, second was Bapu, and third was Father of the Nation. Let me say something about each of these three, mainly concentrating on the third. Now, the Mahatma, there is some controversy who gave him the title. Some people say Tagore gave it. No, that's not true. Long before Tagore, local municipalities in India, which had given him Manapatra, had used the word Mahatma. But even before they used it, Gandhi had himself used it with reference to Socrates and Homer in his translation of Plato's Apology into Gujarati. In that book, it talks about Mahatma Socrates and Mahatma Homer. It's interesting that the title he more or less invented has now become his permanent property and exclusively associated with him. It is also important to bear in mind that Gandhi himself didn't care for the title Mahatma. He found it suffocating, with the result that no one in the Sabarmati Ashram was allowed to use it to refer to him. They always had to call him Gandhiji, not Mahatma. This was a title he thought only his strangers and enemies could use, but not his friends. What about Bapu? Now, Bapu is close to the father, but not quite. It's a Gujarati word, also used in some other Indian languages. It's an informal, endearing, affectionate Gujarati word, usually used to refer to father, but not always. I grew up in a family where my nephews would call my father Bapu, because they saw me calling him Bapu. Nehru, for example, when he announced the death of Gandhiji in Lok Sabha, he said, and I quote, "Our beloved leader, Bapu as we called him, the father of the nation, is no more." So he preferred to call him Bapu as we called him, the father of the nation. It's very interesting. We called him Bapu, the father of the nation, is simply given as a phrase as if it is widely already accepted. Let me now turn to the father of the nation. Listen, father is not just an English translation of Bapu. To call, for many individual Indians to call him Bapu does not amount to calling him the father of the nation. I'm sorry about this. Father of the nation is a qualitative jump from Indians calling him Bapu. The point is as follows. The phrase father of the nation, we are told, was first used by Subhash Bose on his radio broadcast from Singapore on 6th of July, 1944. Well, that's true and not true. The phrase father of the nation was already in circulation. Gandhi had used it in Hind Swaraj with reference to Dadabhai Navroji. Several other people had also used it with reference to Dadabhai Navroji. Gandhi had also used that part of that phrase the reference to Gokhale in Hinswaraj, when he called him a parent of India. Not the father, not the parent, a parent of India and the author of Indian nationalism. So the phrase was already in circulation. Could it be that Subhash was the first to apply to Gandhi? That although the phrase was in circulation, perhaps Subhash was the first to apply to Gandhi. Quite possible, but I doubt it. I doubt it for two reasons. First of all, Subhash used it, according to this story, in July 1944. I can't imagine that a phrase as catchy as this would have waited until 1944 before it brought into public use. And secondly, I can't imagine Subhash simply thinking it up out of the air in 1944. It must have been in circulation. But how and when, I have not been able to trace. I would greatly welcome your help. And if there are any historians or students of Mahatma here, they might be able to put me right and tell me where I can find the phrase either Rashtrapita or Father of the Nation first used with reference to Gandhi. My own suspicion is that it must have been used in late 20s or early 30s. And maybe Professor Chakravarti, who has done excellent work on Mahatma, might be able to set us on the right path. Late 20s or early 30s. Why? Because to be father of the nation, the man has to be old enough to be a father. And before 1920, Gandhi was not that old. And secondly, the father of the nation means that he must have already built a nation or on the way of building a nation. And that didn't happen until the non-cooperation movement and the Gandhi's role in it. So I suggest that somewhere around 1920s, late 20s, early 30s, the phrase must have been in circulation. It's also important, just an aside, it's worth noting that making Subhash, the author of the phrase, serves an important purpose. It shows that even someone like Subhash, who was critical of Gandhi, who had a power struggle with Gandhi, could call him father of the nation, which gives the phrase a broader base than it normally would, and it makes it more acceptable to the left as well as to the right. Anyway, this is the first part of the story. We need to find who used it first. Subhash certainly did not, and other sources we need to track. Let me now turn to the second part of the question, which is how valid a description is it? Well, to call somebody father of the nation means two things. First of all, he created the Indian nation. That is to say, he made India a nation. And secondly, he gave the nation a certain character, a certain self-understanding, a certain way of looking at itself and its past. Of the two, it is the making India a nation is a more direct connotation of father of the nation than the second one. But I'll take both together. So the question is, in what sense is it true to say that Gandhi created the Indian nation and gave it a certain character? Or to put it differently, in what sense is it true to say that Gandhi made India into a nation and gave it a certain character? I think he did it in the following ways. First of all, the struggle for independence in India was very different from that in most of the rest of the world. It was a struggle in which every Indian could join. You don't need to be trained into violence to do that. The non-violent struggles had this advantage. It could have a broad base. Anyone can join anytime, anywhere. It brought in different regions and different groups from Champaran and others, Bardoli. It brought in women. In fact, I am told that Gandhi brought women in much larger number in politics than Mao Zedong. Scheduled tribes, Thakkar Baba and others who worked with Gandhi, Rock Scheduled Tribes into the independent struggle. Nandi March meant that Indians all over the country were able to participate in making salt, not only in Gandhi, the Gandhi himself led the movement, but in other parts of the country, wherever there were pools of water. He wrote in peasantry. Although mainly middle peasantry. So in this way, he bound together different classes, different groups, different regions. The one he didn't succeed very much in bringing together were the industrial working classes. But that's a different story. The other important thing is that he built up uniquely personalized relations with Indians. So his journals, he was able to communicate with them directly. Correspondence, hundreds of letters that he would get every day, and he would reply to at least a tenth of them. Through his travel, he was able to connect with people and establish his own contacts. Through his language, through his manners, in all these ways, he was able to influence different parts of India. Constant travel, constant movement, constant journal articles and all that, bringing them all into politics, with the result that the whole of India began to feel a surge of new energy. And wittingly or unwittingly, this way of bringing the country together made Gandhi himself begin to think that he was the father of the nation. He began to behave like one. This is extraordinary. He began to behave like one. He chided Indians as a father bolder, saying, you're not public-minded, you're not public-spirited, you speak anywhere and that kind of thing. He attacked their weaknesses. He gave them advice on small and large things, how to eat, what not to eat, what do you do when you have a stomach upset. He fasted against them as a father bolder. He gave them moral lessons. It is also interesting that he accepted personal responsibility for things going wrong in India. Riots anywhere, chori chora, I'll come to that in a minute. He felt personally responsible. And if you read Poe's life story, right up to Noakhali, feeling personally, where have I failed? This his identification with the country was extraordinary. And that intensifying the sense of nationhood and identification with him in the country. One simple example, which I find very striking, when he declared Pandit Nehru as his heir, what does it mean? At one level, one would say to Gandhi, look, you are a fool. How can you give away the mantle of legitimacy of the independent struggle, the mantle of your own authority to someone? It is not yours to give away. You do your work and then somebody else. What gives you the right to say to tell Pandit Nehru, you are my heir? Who can make anybody an heir? And this is what he told Pandit Nehru. You are much younger in comparison to me, and therefore I have named you as my heir. I must, however, understand my heir, and my heir should understand me. Therefore, tell me your views on industrialization, post-independence, and I'll react. Now, this kind of talk is almost like Mrs. Gandhi appointing Rajiv or Rajiv appointing Rahul. And yet it is not. So this extraordinary scene where Gandhi anoints his successor and says, you shall be my successor. Not formally, but informally, but equally effectively. That goes to show he had already begun to think of India as his creation, which he was worried about. If it goes into wrong hands, if a wrong leadership comes into power, therefore he says, I have not only created India, but I want to leave it in hands that I can trust. This is also why he went on fast. Remember the last fast, when the government of India refused to share its, to give Pakistan its assets of the independent India. Gandhi, in other words, built bonds between himself and became a bond. They were bonded to him, and through him, they were bonded to each other. In no other country, the relations between the leader and his people were as close as in India. Not surprisingly, Indians disagreed with him on many issues, did the opposite of what he wanted, but nevertheless, they felt that he represented a power to people. There was something about him to which they feel attached and protective about him. So I would say that for all these reasons, Gandhi is rightly called the father of the nation. If you want to use that language, a father, uncle, whatever. And this was expressed in a very strange but interesting and effective way by his assassin, Godse. And Godse, in his statement in the Supreme Court, said the following, and I think that tells a good deal. Here is Godse. Gandhiji is referred to as the father of the nation, an epithet of high reverence. But if so, he has failed in his parental duty, inasmuch as he has acted very treacherously to the nation by consenting to the partition of it. It was for this reason alone that I, as a dutiful son of Mother India, thought it my duty to put an end to the life of this so-called father of the nation. If he was called the father of the nation, Mother India, we are his children, Gandhi's children, and Mother of India, so we children felt that the father should have looked after us in a certain way. He did not. Instead, he was more concerned with Pakistan. Instead of creating India, he created Pakistan, and therefore I had no choice. And because he had created Pakistan rather than India, except the truncated India, he so-called father of the nation. The change in phrase occurs there. So I have argued so far that Gandhi created a nation, but that nation had its limits. He could not succeed in winning over Muslims in large numbers, with the result that India was divided upon the Godse refers to, and its birth was covered in blood. Although this is a subject of great debate, I would argue that the partition was not the result of the failure of Gandhi's vision or the inadequacy of his idea of India, nor the result of his non-violent method of struggle. Rather, it was a result of his strategic and tactical failures of Gandhi and his associates at critical moments in negotiations and India's history. At critical points, lots of issues, I can go through this, but you all know what I'm talking about, including the provincial elections in 1935, at critical negotiations in 1946-47, at critical points, mistakes were made, opportunities were lost, Muslims were alienated, Jinnah was wrongly marginalized, and so on. In other words, it was not inherent in Gandhi's project of nation building that Indian nation should be born truncated or handicapped. With greater caution and sensitivity, India could have been born a single nation. Gandhi's project was basically correct, and his intentions were honorable. His and his associates' decisions at critical moments frustrated his vision. Calling Gandhi the father of the nation is to imply that he not only made India a nation, but also a nation, as I said earlier, of a particular kind. A nation bound together in terms of certain common values in a particular view of itself. In other words, this is quite important, calling Gandhi the father of the nation is a way, another way of defining India's national identity. Gandhi is defined in a certain way, and that definition is used to approve or disapprove of political actions and practices. India is measured on the Gandhian scale. Gandhi therefore inevitably becomes a site of political struggle, a battleground of conflicting interpretations. Like any other leader or thinker, Gandhi is necessarily open to different interpretations. That is not new. What is new is that these interpretations are now shaped by one's politics, one's vision and values, one conception of what India should be, if one thinks that India should be fully armed, like China, and violent and all that, then of course one would not accept the Gandhian view of India. So all interpretations of Gandhi in this context become politically charged and politicized. Let me now turn to the last part of my paper, which is, what are the advantages and what are the disadvantages? Well, that sounds the commercial language. What are the desirable and dubious implications of calling Gandhi the father of the nation, or anybody else the father of the nation? I think the benefits of calling somebody the father of the nation are obvious. First of all, it associates India with a particular individual and the values he represented. So those values, which are salutary in themselves, acquire an additional force of loyalty to that individual. And therefore the values become more appealing, more personalized, more powerful. They become a matter of loyalty to Gandhi, that we should follow these values. It is also important to bear in mind that in calling somebody the father of the nation, these values bind the individual, bind the country together into a single community. They're a glue that holds the country together and form the basis of its sense of nationality. The father of the nation, whoever it is, stands as a guardian, a guarding angel, and provides an additional bond. So I can see some of these advantages in calling somebody the father of the nation. And you see that wherever that phrase is used, whether it's in Kenya or Turkey, Ataturk, or George Washington, or other places, or Indonesia. But I see that wherever that phrase is used, but certainly in India, it also has certain drawbacks. And in my view, these drawbacks outweigh such benefits as it brings. And I want to end by pointing out those drawbacks of using the phrase. First of all, to talk about somebody who is the father of the nation, he has to familiarize political life, to see political life in the image of a family. And once you familiarize political life, it also becomes easy to do the converse, which is to politicize the family. Now, the family and the political life are quite different. There is a strong dividing line. The family is based on love, mutual concern, and so on. Political life is different. In family, people are bonded together, they grow up together with certain attachments and affections. In politics and hierarchy, in politics by contrast, they are equal citizens, keeping a careful watch on the exercise of power, and there is no hierarchy. There is no love. There is some kind of mutual commitment, which we expect that my fellow citizens will love me with an absurd expectation. So first of all, one can't think of political life in terms of categories derived from the family. Secondly, historically speaking, the present then acquires undue importance when you talk about somebody as the father of the nation. India, for example, has, let's say, 4,000 years of history. And different men and women also have shaped that history. Now, to call Gandhi the father of the nation is to ask, well, Gandhi appeared only in the 19th century. What about before him? India before him. Who was the father of that? In other words, the idea of being a father makes sense with respect to a newly created society, a newly created nation. It doesn't make much sense with respect to one that has gone on for hundreds of years and has had many different periods founded by or led by different men. But I want to turn to more substantive disadvantages. Third, as long as Gandhi is seen as the father of the nation, Bothe's phrase, the constantly haunts us, which is we see him with a sense of reverence. It's very difficult even to talk about Gandhi as Gandhi. He has to be called Gandhiji. Even to criticize him, one has to be very cautious. You criticize only some aspects and not others. You can't criticize him as you criticize Karl Marx or John Stuart Mill or Pandit Nehru. He has to be approached with some degree of gentleness, solicitude. Now that, I think, partly explains why the filial piety has stopped many from undertaking a radical critique or a revision of his thought. Every time one hears a critical remark coming from certain circles, the tendency always is to deny it, saying it can't be true or to shut your eyes to it. With the result that the critical analysis of Gandhi, respectful, as of any other individual, respectful but critical analysis, becomes very difficult in a reverential spirit. This also has the opposite consequence, that because some take a reverential attitude, others take the opposite attitude and debunk him for no reason at all. For example, some people would say Gandhi was a racist. There's very little evidence at all. Or that Gandhi was against untouchables and he's simply interested in co-opting them. Again, there is no evidence at all. So what you have is Gandhi becomes a kind of free-for-all, reverential attitude, and therefore the gentle. Reverential attitude, therefore the irreverent. The fourth consequence of calling him father of the nation is his tendency to marginalize the role and importance of others, and to discourage and prevent us from making a fair assessment of them. No great man worked alone. He built a team. He worked through the team. Gandhi would not have been able to achieve half of what he did without Sardar Patel, Pandit Nehru, and others. In concentrating on the father, the role of these men is underestimated. It's underemphasized. Finally, calling Gandhi the father of the nation privileges a certain kind of India and marginalizes or excludes others. India, a nation of Gandhi's creation, Gandhi's imagination, must be non-violent. Otherwise, it is not true to Gandhi. It must lead a simple life of minimal wants. Otherwise, it's not true to Gandhi. In other words, there is a certain way of conceiving a nation which gets privileged, and that's the way India should go. So the father of the nation ceases to be a purely descriptive category. It becomes a normative category, sets an ideal, a benchmark to which India should aim to reach. And this has the consequence of blocking our imagination and limiting the perspectives through which one sees it. So to conclude, my conclusion then is this. I'm not keen on the familiarization of politics and introducing such notions as father, mother, uncle to describe eminent individuals. There are eminent leaders who play important, even decisive roles in history, but they rarely do it alone. They work with others, build teams, recruit followers, and mobilize them. We may single them out for special recognition and honor, but should never put them on a high pedestal, looking down on us as helpless children awaiting their guidance. When we ask, what would Gandhi have done in a particular situation, or how would he have handled a particular problem, we mean one of two things. One of which is acceptable, the other unacceptable. When we ask what would Gandhi have done, he could mean we want to open up a new perspective, a way of looking at things that the Mahatma represented, and we want to use him as our conversational partner. as our interlocutor. Or we might simply turn to him as a guru, as a guide, who will give us clear instructions on what to do. So what is Gandhi relevant, or what would Gandhi have done could mean? What would he say, what would he do in this kind of situation, and then criticizing and commenting on it? As opposed to Gandhian imprimatur, Gandhian concrete ideas from Gandhi. It is striking that of the two, Gandhi himself was always keen on the former and not the latter. In other words, he always wanted people to criticize him, work with him critically, and this is how he looked upon the leaders from whom he borrowed quite a lot. So whether it was Gokhale, or Tilak, or Socrates, or a lot of other people, he used them as his conversation partners, not as gurus who will guide him through life. As he himself said, he had no followers, only fellow seekers, able to think through the political problems. And if you look at Gandhi's own life, he attracted powerful minds having the courage and confidence to disagree with him. After all, it is remarkable that he selected Nehru as his heir, a man who disagreed with him on several important issues with Gandhi's full knowledge. So Gandhi's relevance, like that of any great leader, lies in being our conversational partner, not our guide and guru. If that's what father of the nation means, I can live with the expression. If it means something more, I would want it not to be used. Thank you very much. And once again, I thank my good friend, Professor Bibhishan Chakrabarty, for inviting me to share my thoughts with you.
Thank you, Professor Parekh, for your illuminating talk. And as usual, you always, you know, keep a lot of food for thought insofar as Indian nationalism or Indian political thought is concerned. So now the floor is open for questions. Nimai, if you have questions, otherwise I'd like to begin with. Is there any question? Professor Parekh, may I start? You know, I think, you know, you are an expert. I'm just, you know, a novice and a naive, you can say, insofar as this kind of conceptualizing is concerned. But, you know, my just, you know, understanding of Gandhi suggests that the father of the nation, we are making a mole out of a mountain if we focus too much on this particular expression. With India being a patriarchal society, we tend to appreciate the father more than the mother. Because whenever you refer to the idea of Gandhi being father, my next question will be, who was the mother? There is no mother. So I think, you know, it probably is to be understood with reference to patriarchal bias, which of which we are all product of. So that's one. And secondly, I think, you know, the father of the nation, I cannot tell you exactly the reference, but as far as my knowledge goes, in 1929, when Gandhi met Rabindranath Tagore, I had the transcript of the meeting between these two minds. Tagore addressed, Gandhi first addressed Tagore as Gurudev, and Tagore in response, you know, addressed him as Mahatma. So I think if you want to locate one particular occasion when Mahatma is used, it is the Tagore's reference. But somehow or the other, I didn't find this, you know, the first reference of Gandhi being identified as father of the nation. But I think probably conceptually, it is linked with our patriarchal bias. And I think one of the individuals, I'm sure you know about it, was very critical of Gandhi being father, happens to be Ambedkar. If you look at his speech in the Constituent Assembly, especially the last speech, 25th of November 1949, he was very unhappy simply because he said that being Gandhi, the father of the nation, is very difficult to have democracy in India. because you know religion bhakti is very useful to gain salvation, but in politics, you know, bhakti means unconditional surrender to the God, and here unconditional surrender to the people or to the leader leads to dictatorship or authoritarianism. So I think he was critical of Gandhi being identified as father. I mean, that part I know, but I haven't come across any reference when Gandhi was used as the expression Gandhi being father of the nation is used. So I really don't know. I mean, I think I'll have to work on it. But the Mahatma thing, you know, there is a specific reference of this particular conversation between Tagore and Gandhi, where Gandhi addressed him as Gurudev, and Gurudev addressed him as Mahatma. So that's one. And secondly, I think the idea of Bapu, you said it's a very Gujarati term, but for North India, the idea of Bapu is essentially father. That if you look at the North Indian states, especially Hindi-speaking states, their Bapu invariably means father. So I think the fact that Nehru, Patel, and all his associates, who came from North India, who played a very dominant role in Indian politics then, since they called Gandhiji Bapu or Bapuji, probably the father expression came along. It's just a kind of translation of Bapuji as father. That's my understanding. And one point also I'd like to refer to for your comment. Even Jinnah was identified as Qaid-e Azam. He was also identified as Qaid-e Azam, the leader of the leaders. So I think that, again, nobody knows. Simply the Muslims, addressed Jinnah as Qaid-e Azam. So I think the title, the giving of title is very much in Indian, which you don't find, say, in Western Europe or in North America. So Indians, tend to what is called appreciate the leaders by giving a title. Even now, Mulayam Singh Yadav is known as Netaji. Though when you talk of Netaji, we refer to Subhash Chandra Bose. But nowadays, if you I'm sure you know that Indian politics, Mulayam Singh Yadav, none of his followers ever address him as Mulayam Singh Yadav, the UP patriarchs. He is known as Netaji. So I think I'm sure in course of time, say after 100 years from now on, people will forget that Netaji meant Subhash Chandra Bose, but now Netaji means somebody else. So I think the title is certain thing which is very ingrained in us as human beings. In Indian, it's a very Indian phenomenon which you don't find elsewhere. It's essentially a kind of honorific expression on the part of the Indians to salute or to appreciate the leaders whom they follow. I mean, it's a very stray comment which I made with reference to what you said.
Shall I respond to it?
Please.
Interesting points. Let me respond to them. First of all, father, mother, these are all family terms. Gandhi was called father of the nation, but India is motherland, it's the mother. So if Gandhi is the father, he is married to the mother, and all sorts of humbug begins to arise. But more importantly, Gandhi was androgynous. He rejected the division between man and woman. Manu Gandhi wrote a book called Bapu Mari Ma, Bapu Mari Ba, Bapu My Mother. Gandhi in fact treated her as if he was her mother. Which means that Gandhi was both a man and a woman, both a father and a mother. So to call him a father is to trap him into a gender stereotype or a gender category, which he rejected. But to call him both father and mother would look so absurd internationally that we have very wisely chosen to give him the title of father. That's one. 1929, Tagore and Gandhi meeting. Tagore called him Mahatma. He had called him Mahatma even earlier. Earlier there are references. I'm more concerned with father of the nation. Did Tagore ever call Gandhi Rashtrapita? I would find it very difficult. And in fact, if there was a national poll, which one of the great leaders of India was deserving of the title of Rashtrapita. And I think the choice would be between 3 or 4 people. Let's say Mahatma Gandhi, Pandit Nehru, Tagore. Nehru is the founder of the Indian state. Tagore is the father of the Indian identity, Indian culture. Gandhi is father of the Indian nation. So I don't think Gandhi is an automatic choice. For many people, it would be, must. For intellectuals, he is not an automatic choice. So calling him Mahatma is all right, but calling him father of the nation is what I'm interested in. On the other point, that Gandhi, no democracy was possible. I have heard this many times. And my thing is, at one level, this is true. That the father figure, plus his way of handling things. Take non-cooperation movement. Chori Chora happens after Badoli Satyagraha. Chori Chora happens. And Gandhi said, the movement is withdrawn. Such an extraordinary decision that millions of people were very angry with him. People who were in prison saying, look, young, talented Indians, we are suffering in prison because they fought for your ideas of non-cooperation, and you then withdraw the movement. And what happens? They complain, lots of other people complain. Gandhi said, well, my method requires that wherever there is non-violence, wherever there is violence, this or the result will not be very good. If you don't like it, you will start your own party. Now, a lot of them said, look, Gandhi is the only leader who can unite the country. So in 1920-21, he had become the unquestioned leader of the Indian independent movement within 45 years. So this man could say, look, if you don't want it, fine, I understand. Now, at one level, it looks like another level. But he's saying, look, this is how I think it should be handled. So, this is at one level, he disallowed democracy. At another level, or at least he was such a towering figure that people could not be free in his presence. But at the same time, he welcomed disagreements and discussions, and on many issues, even on this, he was prepared to say, look, I mean, if you don't believe it, fine, you can set up your own party and go and do it, which one somebody might say is a democratic decision. And Qaid-e Azam is a funny thing. This, what does it mean? Azam, Qaid-e Azam, lawgiver, the one who is a leader. He's not the father of the nation. He's a leader, a great leader. I see some other hands going up. Can't hear you.
Hello. Hello. Okay.
Can you hear his voice?
Just now, yes.
Hello.
You. Not him.
Now from participant side.
Can you hear some? Can you hear the voice of my colleague?
Hello, sir. Parik sir, hello.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So, sir, on behalf of the participants, let me bring 2 questions for you. First one is from Madam Unna C. She intend to ask you that my question to Professor Parik has to do with the pitfalls of glorifying political leaders, which are masterfully brought out by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, his last speech to the Constituent Assembly in November 1949, where he said, bhakti or hero worship is a sure road to degradation and to eventual dictatorship, which was most probably a veiled reference to the Bapuization of Gandhi. Notwithstanding the massive contribution that Gandhi made to the Indian people and the world at large, would not you agree that the lionizing of political figures erodes accountability and silences critical voices which is unacceptable in a democratic setup like ours. Sir, what is your opinion? This is first question.
I couldn't hear the last part. My opinion on what?
Let me repeat.
The voice is breaking.
Yeah, notwithstanding.
No, I can't hear you.
Nimai, the voice on.
Oh, Arpita, I can't hear you.
Is that clear to you, Professor Parekh?
Sorry?
Yeah. Now it is
clear.
Audible.
Is that clear?
I can hear you with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that clear to you? Nimai, on the
filter.
Did you hear the question? Professor Parekh, did you hear the question?
I didn't hear anything.
Oh, but now let me repeat, the question which I asked, that the valorization or appreciation of a leader unconditionally leads to the growth of a dictator. That is what Ambedkar referred to in his last speech before the Constituent Assembly. Mm-hmm. But the point which I made, do you have any comment to offer?
No, Ambedkar was right when he said that. He said many things about dictatorship. And he was particularly unhappy with Gandhi.
Mm.
And he said, he was dictatorial and threatening to go on fast for him was the method of a dictator. And I think there was that kind of element, which is why it's very striking that for Hindus, this is more like a father saying, I will not speak to you or I will not eat unless you treat me in a certain way. So that looked like an appeal to your love for him. But to an outsider, it might look like a threat. Blackmail.
Okay. Sure. So another question is that. Okay, yeah. So Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose addressed Gandhi as the father of the nation is dedicated to the fact that Gandhi was a preacher of ahimsa and peace more than being a politician. What do you think about that?
What do I think about what?
Professor Parekh, the question is that Subhash Chandra Bose, you referred to it, addressed Gandhi as the father of the nation. And Gandhi believed in ahimsa, while Subhash Chandra Bose believed in hinsa, violence. So how do you, address this contradiction in Subhash Bose's approach to Gandhi and or in Subhash Bose's identification of Gandhi being the father of the nation?
Yeah. No, Subhash called him father of the nation. If he turns out to be the first, it'll be remarkable. But even if he's not, it's very striking that Subhash, about to engage in soldiers of the Indian Army, mobilizing them, fighting for the British for India's independence, and asking Gandhi's blessings. So the non-violent leader's blessings on the violent movement, that itself is very striking. And I think it goes to show that Gandhi's appeal was not limited to those who cared for non-violence. It also extended to those who did not believe in non-violence. A lot of people didn't. A lot of communists didn't. But they still accepted that this man's method had its own courage, had its own strength. So that when it is Gandhi once said, it's easy to shoot somebody in the dark. It is very difficult to stand up to him in the daylight and say, I shall not do what you want me to do. So in that sense, Gandhi was valued courage far more than he valued non-violence. And that, I think, even the communists accepted.
Professor Parekh, do you agree that it was politically correct for Subhash Chandra Bose to have dedicated, his mission to Gandhiji?
Say it again.
It was, politically correct at that point of time for Subhash Chandra Bose to dedicate his struggle to Gandhiji?
Yes. No, he is not dedicating it. He is asking Gandhiji's blessings. He said, in this battle, father of the nation, in this battle of injustice against justice, we seek your blessings.
No, but if you remember in the INA, there are two brigades. One is Gandhi Brigade, another is Nehru Brigade. So that by characterizing one brigade as Gandhi Brigade, he appeared to have dedicated his mission partly to Gandhiji's, blessing, yes, but to Gandhiji as well.
He dedicated what?
No, by naming one brigade after Gandhi, he really expressed his uncritical respect for the father of the nation.
Yes, but this is what I'm trying to understand, that here was a man whose politics, whose irrationalism people might disagree with. And yet at the end of the day, there was something in him or something about him which lots of Indians felt proud of. I want to understand that. What was it about Gandhi that even today, many of us would say, look, if you are attacking him, please be fair. Be sensible. This is not true. That I think is very important. To grasp the man's quality, which represents India at its best, so that you can remove his hearing the voice of God, or inner voice and all that kind of stuff. And yet at the end of the day, one might say, well, there was something very noble about him, which all communists and others also shared, also appreciated.
But Professor Parekh, let me differ from you with respect. I think today's willingness to take Gandhiji's name is essentially a pretext to hide lot of things which Gandhi would not have approved of.
Absolutely.
For instance, onto a 2nd of October, you'll find a beeline, huge beeline, to get into Rajghat and offer floral tribute to Mahatmas, that Vedi. But I'm sure these people who put on Gandhi topi and participate in the bhajans on that particular day, are involved in those activities throughout the year, which Gandhi would never have approved of. So to me, it's a kind of opportunistic design to hide your original motive. Do you agree or do you have a different point of view?
Yes, no, you're absolutely right. He can be used to cover up many of our sins, even in his lifetime, which is why he said the Congress is using him. And he said, disband Congress and let the new people create a new party and see if they can make it powerful and establish it. And this is what Ambedkar says also. When Ambedkar, in his letter to Sharada Devi, he says, the Congress has become a den of criminals, people fighting each other and using Gandhi as a cover.
Sure. A colleague of mine has asked a question. It's a kind of follow-up of the earlier question that you said Subhash Chandra Bose sought the blessing of Gandhiji. So what was the magic which made Subhash seek his blessing?
Very difficult. If I knew, I think what ultimately won over many people to him was they all knew his love for India. If Subhash loved India, so did Gandhi. Secondly, his way of life. While they could talk about socialism and taking away others' property and distributing it, here was a man who said, I don't want anything. So he shamed them. When Subhash would go and all fully dressed and all the sort of stuff, Gandhi would say, look, I have nothing to give you, nothing to say. I have not saved anything. You want to give away, but I don't have anything to give away. So I think that kind of renunciation, giving up everything. A man who had been to London, a barrister, South Africa, all these years, the man who would have made lots of money, gave up everything. And this, I think in our tradition, and in our sanskara, in our genes, there is always this enormous respect for a renouncer, sacrifice. Sapu de diya. That Lata Mangeshkar song, Mere Desh ke log ko yaad karo kurbani. ये शहीद की कुर्बानी को याद करो कि कुर्बानी जो है इस आदमी की वो जबरदस्त है दैट पुट्स एवरीबॉडी टू शेम सो व्हेन दे गिव एंड गिव लेक्चर्स टू हिम सेइंग आई एम अ सोशलिस्ट ही शुड बी टीचिंग सोशलिज्म ही सेज वेल प्लीज यू गॉट अ हाउस हैवंट यू यू हैव गॉट दिस हैवंट यू व्हाट काइंड ऑफ अ सोशलिस्ट आर यू फर्स्ट बी द चेंज यू वांट टू सी इन द वर्ल्ड So why don't you start changing it? Why don't you give it all away? I think when Subhash first went to see Gandhiji, he had just come from Cambridge, suited and booted. He went to see Gandhi. And Gandhi was doing his charkha. And Subhash went there. And Gandhi says, wait, where is he going to sit? So Gandhi offered him the only chair he had. And he said, sit on that chair. And Subhash, the first question, what is your program for India? And Gandhi said, I have no program. He continued to spin. And the conversation lasted for about 10 minutes. And Gandhi's summing up of Subhash at the first meeting was very interesting. He told Malaviyaji, he said, Subhash came to see me. I think he should go and see C.R. Das, who will handle him best. And Gandhi suggested Subhash, C.R. Chandraman Das ji ko jaake milie.
I think, you know, he referred to this incident in his Indian struggle book.
Yes.
That he said, I was very disappointed having seen the so-called leader of the nation. And he found C.R. Das, you know, more organized, more disciplined. He had a kind of, you know, political blueprint for India. So which attracted both to C.R. Das. You know, I have a kind of conjectural idea that had C.R. Das been alive beyond 1925, probably Indian nationalist movement would have taken a different shape altogether. Because he was also growing in importance. You know, look at his popularity in the Gorakh. C.R. Das, you know, became very, no, C.R. Das. You know, see his popularity in 1922 Gaya Congress.
Yeah.
He was the one who was accepted by everybody, you know, as the next kind of, you know, leader, the leader of the country. So I think, you know, his kind of, you know, untimely death in 1925, it took a very able leader away from the scene in India at that point of time. So I still believe that it was C.R. Das, if he stayed around, if he was alive, then probably the partition would not have taken place. Because, you know, again, it's a conjecture, you know, but you know, it's a long argument which I put forward in my book on partition. You remember that, you know, we had discussion. And you said that partition, when you think of partition of the country, it's not partition of the country, it's the partition of only two provinces, Bengal and Punjab. But you know, its impact was national.
Yes.
So I mean, I pursued that point in my book, 2004 book on partition. And there, you know, I still strongly feel that C.R. Das probably was the only Indian politician at that point of time who realized the growing importance of the Muslims in you know, kind of institutional politics. And he wanted to accommodate all the, you know, important Muslim leaders, especially from East Bengal. And, you know, but once he passed away, you know, the leaders who had grassroots connection, both in West Bengal and in East Bengal, were just hounded out. And they, you know, left Calcutta, the center of activities, to various kind of, you know, mafushal towns or, you know, non-urban centers, and they became very important later. You know, Mednipur. I mean, Mednipur is one example where you find this nationalist, you know, Biren Shashmal. He was the leader of the Bengal Provincial Congress in 1926, but Subhas didn't agree with his ideology of non-violence. He was simply, you know, hounded out of the kind of pandal, one of the, you know, the podium of the Bengal Provincial Congress annual meeting. And he organized the volunteers in Midnapore, and that resulted in the formation of provisional government in 1942. The same is true in some other places in East Bengal as well. I mean, J.M. Sengupta is another leader who was, you know, kind of co-opted by C.R. Das because of his success of organizing the Chittagong dock workers. But the moment C.R. Das disappeared from the scene, he was also hounded out by Subhash Chandra Bose. So Subhash Chandra Bose, you know, by being kind of, you know, swayed by revolutionary nationalist perspective, didn't allow any of the Gandhians to flourish in Bengal Provincial Congress. And the result was disastrous, you know, the partition. I think if C.R. Das was alive, if the C.R. Das kind of politics was allowed to prosper, probably things would have been different in India. Again, you know, it's a conjecture, because if you look at the processes at the grassroots, you know, separating Hindus from Muslims, especially in East Bengal, that has a class dimension as well. Probably partition would not have been halted. But still, I have a feeling if C.R. Das was around, he would have devised a mechanism to address that kind of, you know, segregation between Hindus and Muslims at that point of time. At least, you know, his ideas in the 20s, when Muslims became a very strong community and the leadership, you know, was gaining strength day by day. I think, you know, if Bose followed C.R. Das's modes of accommodating interest, or diverse interest, probably things would have been different in India.
Yeah, I think you're right.
I think, you know, there's a chapter in my book, you know, this 2004 book. It's a very conjectural way of thinking, because, you know, when I go to Bangladesh and I come back every time, you know, crying, because I still strongly feel kind of emotional bond with those people in Bangladesh. And nowadays I find, especially after this Awami League regime, a lot of people are, you know, questioning the partition, which was not the case about 10 years or 12 years ago. But nowadays there is a kind of, you know, feeling that if Germany can be brought together, if Korea can be brought together, why not India, Bangladesh? So, you know, we can think of a confederation kind of states, but we can be together. But I don't know, I mean, at this point of time, given the rising importance of terrorism, whether it is going to happen or not, but still, you know, emotionally, several Bangladeshis, those who matter in decision-making process, they still, you know, appreciate the idea of being together with India as one state, not nation, one state.
Okay, Vidyut Babu.
Thank you very much, Parek Sahab. And ये खुशी का बात है that आपने मेरा दावत स्वीकार कर लिया. And again, I am telling you that, you know, your invitation stands. Whenever you are in India, please do not disappoint us this time. And I pray to God that you आप सुस्त रहिए. भगवान से मैं प्रार्थना करता हूँ, आप सुस्त रहिए. And प्रमिला जी को लेके please हमारा शांतिनिकेतन पधारिए. And you will like the place, you will enjoy the, you know, the surroundings, and you will also get a sense of history once you land in Shantiniketan. Bahut bahut dhanyawad. Aap sust rahiye, bhagwan se ye mere prarthana hai.
Main aapko bahut bahut dhanyawad ki aapne humko bulaya, aur aapka adesh tha to hum chale aaye yahan. Mali nahi hai, purane dost hain aap, jab bulate hain hum chale aayenge.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord Parekh. I didn't address you as Lord
Parekh.
I know. My daughter was reminding me, you know, this morning that, Papa, you remember we had chai in Parliament canteen, sorry, in Westminster canteen. Remember you took us to House of Lords?
Yes.
Yeah, my daughter is also listening to you. She is one of the participants. She was very excited. My daughter.
Where is your daughter now?
Now they are here in Shantiniketan because of COVID-19 outbreak. They couldn't get back to Delhi since March.
Right.
So they're with me. It's quite, you know, fortune for me. I am fortunate to have them around. Because as you said,
remember me to her.
Please.
I have to see her once this virus is over.
Yeah, I know. Please, please. You know, as you said, you were always. She's doing philosophy and she is glued to Ambedkar.
Ambedkar.
B.R. Ambedkar. Yeah. She's really working on that. And I don't know whether you saw my book on Ambedkar, because while working on Ambedkar, you know, she...
I haven't seen book on. There are two books of yours. I made a note of it. One is this Ambedkar and the other is Hindu nationalism.
these are the books which are published by Routledge, but the Sage book, I mean, that you will also find interesting. It's about Gandhi versus others, you know, other three. I mean, the point which you made, that Gandhi would not have achieved half of what he did without the support of his colleagues, I still strongly feel that. Anyway, I think you are looking at your watch, so your time is running out. You know, as you know, whenever I enjoy, you know, I see you, I continue to talk with you. I know I cannot afford the luxury at this point of time. So please do come. We'll spend a lot of time together.
Thank you. Thank
you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Namaskar.
Namaskar. Namaskar. Namaskar.
Let's keep in touch.
Thank you. We'll be in touch. Thanks a lot. Thank you.